Hi, and welcome to our new video series on object-oriented programming with Java. This video series is a logical extension of the two previous video series, namely Basics of Programming and Programming with Scratch. So, if you don't know much about programming, I recommend that you refer to those video series before proceeding with this one. First thing first, what is object-oriented programming and what's so special about it? Object-oriented programming, or OOP, is simply put an approach to programming based on using objects that interact with each other. What is an object in OOP? As I've mentioned in the previous video series, the only thing computers do is they process data. We have covered different types of data like integer and floating point numbers, characters, and so on. An object in OOP is yet another form or type of data. This begs the question of how objects are different from those types of data that we have previously covered. A simplified answer to this question would be that objects can act as containers for other types of data, including other objects. Some of you might remember that in one of the previous videos, we did use a type of data that represents a collection of other pieces of data. I'm talking about arrays. We did use arrays of characters to represent text in the C programming language. Objects in OOP are somewhat similar to arrays in that they too can contain other pieces of data. However, while arrays can only store data of one type, such as characters or numbers only, objects in OOP can store various types of data, including other objects. So what, some of you might ask, why is this so important? Let me show you an example. Imagine a bicycle. A typical bicycle consists of a couple of wheels, a frame, a saddle, and a handlebar. There are of course other components, but to keep it simple, we'll only consider these four. Now, have you ever heard anyone say something like, I got a new set of two wheels, a frame, a saddle, and a handlebar? Probably not, but if you have, please leave a comment below this video. The point is that we normally do not view a bicycle as a set of its components. For one, the word bicycle is shorter than a list of its components. It's easier to say the word bicycle than to list its components. This analogy can be applied to objects in OOP. Instead of having a bunch of data pieces all independent of one another, we can put them together into an object and give that object a name. This will make it easier for us to handle that bunch of data pieces. In other words, OOP makes it somewhat easier for us to handle data in the form of objects, which becomes particularly helpful if you're creating a complex program containing a lot of code. This bicycle analogy might be helpful in explaining some benefits of using objects, but it's hardly of any use in explaining what an OOP object is. What might be helpful here is Scratch that we used in the previous video series. Every character that we add to a program is an example of an OOP object. Again, an object in OOP is a data container. Some of you might ask, what kind of data does an object in Scratch contain? Well, in fact, any Scratch object contains a lot of data. For example, it contains costumes or sprites. A sprite is an image, and an image is a form of data. If you're not familiar with Scratch and you are having trouble making sense of OOP objects, I do recommend that you refer to the Scratch video series. Another basic concept of OOP is class. Simply put, an OOP object is created from a class. You write code for classes and then use these classes to create objects. A natural question is, why make things so complicated? Why can we not just write code for objects directly? Well, one reason is that you can use one class to create multiple objects. There are many analogies for the class-object relationship. One of them is that a class is somewhat similar to a rubber stamp. It can use one stamp to create a bunch of similar images. Some of you might have realized that we did use this feature in Scratch when making the bat shoot multiple fireballs. We didn't have to create code for every single fireball. We only created it once and then used a block to clone the ball every time we had the bat launch one. It would in fact have been annoying if we had to create the same code for a bunch of identical balls. Let's do a quick summary before it gets too overwhelming. Object-oriented programming, or OOP, is an approach to creating computer programs. OOP is based on using objects. Objects, in a nutshell, are just pieces of data that can contain other pieces of data. Using objects makes it somewhat easier for us to handle large amounts of data. Objects are created from classes. A single class can be used to create multiple objects of the same type. To create computer programs using the object-oriented approach, we need a programming language that supports OOP. There are a lot of programming languages. Some of them are exclusively object-oriented, some of them are not object-oriented at all, and some support both object-oriented and non-object-oriented programming. For example, the C programming language that we used in one of the previous video series is non-object-oriented. And Scratch, as mentioned before, is somewhat object-oriented. In this video series, we'll be using Java, an exclusively object-oriented programming language. In the next video, we'll talk more about Java and why we use it in this video series. And this is it for today. See you next time. Bye.